कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए दूसरे चरण में हम पहुंचते हैं। अध्यादेश जो जारी हुआ है, सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट ने किया है, उसके बारे में हम बात करेंगे। जैसे कि हमने देखा, द फंडामेंटल चैलेंज बिफोर ओवरबर्डेंड पुलिस फोर्स टुडे लाइज इन द फेथफुल डिस्चार्ज ऑफ इट्स ड्यूटी, बिकॉज पुलिस इज ओवरबर्डेंड, एज सर हैज सजेस्टेड, टू इन्वेस्टिगेट क्राइम एट द सेम टाइम टू कैरी आउट लॉ एंड ऑर्डर एंड अदर एंसिलरी एक्टिविटीज विच वी नाउ आर फोकसिंग। सो क्वालिटी ऑफ इन्वेस्टिगेशन इटसेल्फ इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट सोफिस्टिकेटेड टास्क एंड इट डिटरमिन्स द इफिकेसी ऑफ क्रिमिनल जस्टिस सिस्टम। सो इट इज ऑफन इंडोर्ड शेडोड एज इमरजेंस ऑफ न्यू पेनल लॉस, लाइक वी हैव सीन द ऑर्डिनेंस विच हैज कम आउट इम्पोजिंग सम पेनल प्रोविजंस इन द ओरिजिनल एपिडेमिक एक्ट। सो चैलेंज ऑफ COVID-19 इज अपॉर्चून टाइम टू इंट्रोस्पेक्ट ऑन सच वाइटल एस्पेक्ट्स। फॉर दिस आई विल रिक्वेस्ट श्री ML Sharma sir, who has been a distinguished investigator and on whom our apex court has entrusted many investigations, including that of former CBI director. I request Shri ML Sharma sir to remind our audience with his address on the topic efficacy of Epidemic Disease Amendment Ordinance 2020. Sharma sir.
In this session, first, I must place on record my regards to Shri Prakash Singh Ji, who is icon of our service, in fact, icon of the nation. Then, namaskar to all the viewers. I'm here to speak to you briefly about the amendments made to the Epidemic Disease Act of 1897 in the context of COVID-19. See, the British government enacted a law called the Epidemic Disease Act 1987 about 123 years back. It was a very brief act containing only three sections. And section two of the act was the most important. It said that when the state government found that any and that the state or any part thereof was threatened with an outbreak of any dangerous epidemic disease, and that the ordinary provisions of the law for the time being in force in that state were not adequate to handle the problem, then the state government could empower any person, any officer, any person and private person to take such measures as were necessary to prevent the outbreak of such disease or to prevent spread thereof. This was the main provision of the principal act, that is Act of 1987. Now, subsequently, in 1920, Section 2A was inserted in this act, by which the powers conferred on the central government, on the state government, were also conferred on the central government of the day. The section 3 provided the penal provision, and it was that if any person does not obey the directions of the public servant or authorized officer, then case could be launched against him under section 188 of the Indian Penal Code. As you all know, the very mild section is punishable imprisonment in 3 years, no arrest can be made, and it's a complaint case. It's not a charge sheet case. This was the law. Now, COVID-19 came to this country in a big way, and we're still struggling with it. And there was recurrence of attacks on the medics, the doctors, the nurses, the supporting staff, community health worker, and so on and so forth. Of course, there were attacks on the police also in a big way. And some attacks were inspired by communal considerations, but I'll not go to that. The central government felt that the penal provisions of the Principal Act were grossly inadequate. And therefore, the central government issued an ordinance called the Epidemic Diseases Amendment Ordinance 2020. So I will give you the salient features of this ordinance. But before I do that, I would also like to very briefly attract your attention to the Disaster Management Act 2005. The Ministry of Home Affairs is issuing all directions to the state governments and to its own departments under the authority of this law. Section 2D of Disaster Management Act defines disaster. I'm deliberately raising this issue, and I want to read out that definition. And I leave it to you whether the present epidemic covered in disaster, because this section, this clause doesn't mention disease at all. I quote, disaster means a catastrophe, mishap, calamity, or grave occurrence in any area arising from natural or man-made causes or by accident or negligence, which results in substantial loss of life, etc., etc. Now, I would like to interpret this clause liberally, and I would say COVID-19 is a disaster, but you are free to hold a different view, and be it as it may, all the directions of lockdown, other restrictions that are being imposed by the central government are being issued under this Disaster Management Act, even though epidemic disease or no disease has expressly been covered under the expression disaster. Now, I also incidentally mentioned, Prakash Singh Ji also referred to that very briefly, to this, that there are 4 or 5 penal sections in this law, and they're very, very mild in nature. I need not go into detail in them. All that they say is that if somebody disobeys the directions of a public authority or whatever, then he can be prosecuted and punishment will be 1 year or something like that. This is the state of penal affairs as far as control and management of epidemic in this country is concerned. Now, I come to the ordinance. This ordinance is in length 4 times bigger than the Principal Act. The first feature of this ordinance is that the expression act of violence, quotes, has been defined very liberally. What is act of violence? 1, harassment impacting the living and working conditions of healthcare service personnel. I'll call them medics for sake of brevity. Harassment impacting the living or working conditions. What it means is some nurses, some doctor living rent something, and they go to the hospital, they treat people, they come back, and the mohalla wala say no, or landlord say no, you are bringing virus, and therefore you leave our place. To cover this kind of situation is happening. It has happened in Delhi. Two, more important, harm, injury, hurt, intimidation, or danger to the life of medics. Three, obstruction or hindrance to such medics in the discharge of their duties. This has been necessary. This, necessary to cover this aspect because you see, hospitals have been vandalized, nursing homes have been vandalized, so on and so forth. So therefore, any hindrance to the medics in the discharge of duties, you know, nurses and doctors, they have been maltreated and they have been harassed, particularly female nurses, by certain people. So to cover all these aspects, this clause has been there. And last, and very important, loss or damage to any property or documents in custody of the medics, tier of medical records, your own records, somebody else's records. So all this has been covered. So this expression act of violence covers these four aspects of harassment, harm or injury caused to the medics. Now, importantly, very stringent punishment has been provided for commission of acts of violence by anyone. The law says, the ordinance says that the minimum imprisonment will be 6 months, which may extend to 5 years, and certain circumstances where grievous hurt has been caused, grievous hurt has been caused, which is punishable under Section 320 Indian Penal Code, then even 7 years imprisonment . Now the third aspect, which according to me is more important than the first two, is that the trial will be conducted by the courts on day-to-day basis, and it shall be completed within 1 year's time. And if the trial can't be completed within 1 year, then the trial court can extend it by 6 months. In 6 months lapse, he can give it to himself by recording reasons in writing. And the last and important aspect is, which has implications for the Indian Evidence Act, it is that presumption has been raised against the accused who is arraigned for trial, which means that if charge sheet is filed against anyone under this ordinance, then the court shall presume that he has committed the offense. In fact, the law goes on to say that the court shall presume that the accused had the mens rea, the mental state to commit that crime. So, you know, like in regard to atrocities in women and all, Section 114 of the Evidence Act has been amended. It's almost amendment of the Evidence Act. Presumption has been raised against the accused. So these are the salient provisions of the Amendment Act. Now, question is whether this will do, whether this will achieve the objective for which this ordinance has been issued. My first response is that promulgation of this ordinance is a very robust response on the part of central government and I commend it. But in my opinion, the law or the amendment, the ordinance has certain deficiencies. Now, the first, in my opinion, is that this ordinance provides protection to the medics only in the context of dangerous diseases or epidemics. Corona has come, corona will go, but going by the past experience, we all know that doctors are harassed, intimidated, assaulted, even in ordinary course of life across the country. I read a piece by Dr. V.K. Sareen, a very famous doctor's country. He wrote a couple of days back in the Indian Express. He has brought out, very vividly brought out the problem which the medics are facing this country in ordinary times. So for the corona period, COVID-19 period is good enough. But as Prakash said, 10 months we'll overcome this problem, maybe earlier we overcome this problem, and we come to the square one. Then the medics will have no protection. So temporary nature of this legislation is a problem area. Of course, through ordinance only, temporary measure could have been adopted in the sense that this ordinance could have been issued only in the context of affidavit because of the amendment to the Dangerous Diseases Act. But I'm saying it has a temporary nature. In routine course, it keeps on happening. Doctors are being harassed, humiliated, attacked, assaulted, and mostly for imaginary reasons. Sometimes, of course, they have problems. Sometimes overcharging, sometimes not looking after the... Nevertheless, attack on them is not justified in any case. So, impermanency or temporary nature of this ordinance is an issue. Now, second point that I have in mind is that Prakash Singh said very rightly that police and paramilitary forces are as much exposed to virus and to all kind of medical risks as the medics. Now, the medics have been covered under this ordinance, but police personnel, paramilitary personnel, you see, their suffering, it has been lost sight of. According to me, they equally deserve the same protection, even though it's temporary in nature, but they deserve this protection. Of course, compensation, case of death and other things, Kasi raised the issue, that is a different aspect. It's not in the framework of the law that I'm talking about. I'm not talking about that. I'm saying the police and paramedics, we have lost so many people. Somebody's hand has been cut off. So many people are undergoing, they contacted corona, they're undergoing treatment. So, and they have been attacked, particularly Delhi, Moradabad, other places, and across the country. I mean, why not name one place? So therefore, they needed this protection, which according to me, has been unjustifiably denied to them. Now, third point that I wish to make is that even though the ordinance says that trial will be conducted on day-to-day basis, even the Prevention of Corruption Act says that, but has never happened. We in India, post-independence, have lost the concept of day-to-day trial. It remains only in the statute book. I don't know what has happened to our judicial brethren. They don't seem to believe in it. One peshi, half a witness examined, and then 6 months, no trace of the case, and no trace of the accused, no trace of the witnesses. This is what is happening. So this is not going to happen. Anyway, but the ordinance also puts a limit of 1 year on the trial, commendable. The amended Prevention of Corruption Act 2018 also makes this provision. There it is, 2 years. But again, extension of 6 months to be granted by the trial court himself. To me, it doesn't make any sense.
It should have been upper limit of, make it 2 years, doesn't matter. Because I'm making this point because trial is at the heart of the whole matter. I've heard certain chief ministers saying, I'll impose NSA and things like that. According to me, all this not justified in small matters. NSA is meant for something very serious. Ordinary law of the land should take care of such situations. So, you see, deterrence in law is not in putting the law in the statute book. Deterrence fructifies when convictions happen. And convictions happen, convictions have meaning when trial is concluded within a reasonable time frame. 1 year, make it 2 years, don't mind, but not beyond 2 years. And even if the lawmakers, the central government wanted to have this provision, then extension, discretion of extension of 6 months, etc., should not have been vested with the trial judge. It should have been vested with the High Court. Reason being that the trial courts are very scared of the High Court. Some of you are practicing lawyers, you know. They'll be feeling very shy of going to High Court, because it will reflect on their efficiency. And when presumption is being drawn against the accused, and when it is not a blind case or something, you know, there's one version of the investigating agency, there's one version of the eyewitnesses, there's another version of the accused defense side. It's very easy for the court to believe one version or the other. Therefore, 1 year's time was good enough. And if you make it 2 years, doesn't matter, but extension business should stop. So the reason being that, you know, on average, one ordinary case takes 3 to 5 years. If decision is going to come after 3 to 5 years, then this deterrence will remain only in paper and it will not have a real effect on the ground. So these are the few points that I had in mind about the, so according to me, law is commendable, but it is inadequate. Now, what do I suggest? My suggestion would be that there should be further ordinance to give protection to the police and paramilitary personnel, or for that matter, all personnel who are involved one way or the other in the control of Corona 19. This amendment should be made, or fresh ordinance should be brought in. This is one. This is a temporary measure. Long-term measure, according to me, would be that the provisions made in the ordinance should be incorporated in the Indian Penal Code and in the Indian Evidence Act. Reason is that if you attack a public servant, there's a provision in the Indian Penal Code, 332 and things like that. 188 is also there, but it has not worked because this Amendment Act brings the concept of raising a presumption and so on and so forth and provides more stringent punishment. And I forgot to tell you, the offenses are cognizable and non-bailable. They are cognizable and non-bailable. Lawyers don't like this. I also run a small law firm, but I'm a quintessential policeman. You see, law has to, the force of law has to be brought with all its vigor on the lawbreakers. So therefore, you know, all these provisions should be incorporated in the Indian Penal Code and in the Evidence Act, and law should be given permanency. This is all that I had to say about this ordinance. Thank you very much. You're welcome to ask me any questions or make any suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We are much obliged for your illuminating lecture on this subject. Sir has beautifully explained the flow of this Epidemic Act, flowing from 1897, then 1922, and then to present ordinance being promulgated by the Government of India. Sir has gone through various sections dealing with important aspects like penalty. And sir has also emphasized on the why this ordinance was need of the hour, to protect our medical workers against any untoward accident being exercised against them by anyone. In brief, he has also described the Disaster Management Act 2005, and sir has attributed this COVID-19 as a disaster in terms of definition contained in Disaster Management Act. Sir has also shown that this ordinance is four times bigger than the principal act itself, and it widely deals with the relevant need of the hour which has arisen due to this. On the deficiency side, sir has highlighted that although medicos has been covered in this ordinance, but what was the need of the hour is also to include the police and paramilitary personnel, because same protection is also needed for them. And this ordinance is temporary in nature. Sir has emphasized that this such type of protection should be of permanence nature. And day-to-day trial by the court has also been incorporated up to the maximum period of 1 year, which may be extended by 6 months. So sir has suggested that this provision should be strictly dealt with. And it may be extended to 2 years, but within that time frame, trial must be completed so as to emphasize, to create the deterrence in amongst the general public regarding this. Sir, thank you very much for this illuminating lecture to our audience.